So, welcome everyone to the today's session. The topic of today's discussion is secondary structure prediction. How you can go for secondary structure prediction and what are the tools that you can use if you want to predict the secondary structure of any kind of tool. That means how you can predict it, how you can analyze it. That is the main topic of today's discussion. So starting with the very introductory part, first of all, if you talk about proteins are made up of amino acids. So the primary structure of protein is amino acid sequence, this one. So you can say these are the amino acids that are, you know, that are present in a particular sequence that make up a protein. Then after the primary structure comes secondary structure. So secondary structure can be alpha helix, it can be beta sheet, beta pleated sheet, you must have heard about it. So the local conformation of this secondary structure, they are stabilized by many type of forces, hydrogen bonding. After that it comes tertiary structure, then quaternary structure. Tertiary structure, whenever you study three-dimensional structure, 3D structure, that is basically formed by when all the secondary structure of a particular protein, they assemble together. Then is quaternary structure, last one, that is the structure which is formed by more than one polypeptide chain. That means there are many number of polypeptide chains and they combine together to form a quaternary structure. So this is the basic introductory part, you must have studied about it. Our main topic is secondary structure. What is this secondary structure? Basically, the local conformation of protein backbone, it is defined by secondary structure. Because in the primary structure, when the primary structure folds, it becomes a secondary structure. There are two major types, alpha helix and beta sheets. You can divide it in two parts. That is regular secondary structure, which is alpha helix and beta sheet. And irregular secondary structure, which you must have studied about, tight turns, random coil, random bulges. So these are some irregular secondary structures that sometimes they may originate. Now, these structures, why we want to study these structures, why we need to establish these, why we need to study that this is the structure of this very protein. Because, first of all, the ample amount of information we can have from these structural information. Like you go for protein classification, you can predict the function of many uncharacterized and many unknown proteins. You can even tell that whether this protein is interacting with some other protein to make a stabilized conformation or not. Whether it is interacting with any kind of ligands, whether it is interacting with metal ions, substrates, glycosides, cofactors, inhibitors, you can establish the complete working mechanism of that very protein if it is, having some enzymatic activity. You can go for structure activity relationship study. You can go for structure-based drug development that you have studied in molecular docking section. In that case also, you need to, first of all, isolate the structure. You need to, download the PDB file of a particular structure that you want to act or a particular protein onto which you can you want to develop the drug against which. So many kind of post-translational modification information can be harnessed from this, like disulfide bonds, whether it is N-glycosylated, O-glycosylated. So you can have an ample amount of information from the structural part. But the folding pattern, that how the primary structure of amino acid, it gets folding. The folding pattern of this polypeptide chain, that is basically dependent upon two main angles. You have read about it, but I am very briefly touching these topics just to, give it a brief touch. So you must have studied about phi and psi angle. Phi and psi angle. Phi angle between C and N and psi angle between carbon and carbonyl. So here in this omega, it corresponds to the trans, it can take trans or cis conformation. And this exception of this pi psi and omega angles is only in the case of proline amino acid, because that is known as helix breaker. In case, if in a protein, a proline is present and the structure is basically, the secondary structure of that very protein is alpha helix, the alpha helix will break there wherever the proline would be there. So this is the exception. So there are some key facts about it. These chemical bonds, pi and psi angles, they have some specific characteristic length between these chains, that C and carbon and carbon alpha. They have partial double bond character. That means they show resonance property also. Some of the bonds are single bonds, so as to restrict the rotation of the bonds. So all of these things you have studied in your biochemistry thing. You have studied about Ramachandran plot also, that the secondary structure has a characteristic combination of pi and psi angle. So this is the Ramachandran plot that you people have studied, in which the restricted areas and allowed areas and allowed range is being mentioned. As you can see, the red color part is showing no steric hindrances there. If a phi and psi angle of a particular protein is lying in this very location, yellow one is, that means there are some steric hindrance. White is forbidden zone, that a protein can't fold in a manner if the phi and psi angle is lying in that very zone. And only exception is glycine, because it is having no side chain. Glycine is the first amino acid, and glycine is the only amino acid in which hydrogen is the side chain. So it can be found in the white region. Now, first secondary structure, alpha helix. If you talk about alpha helix, okay. So if you talk about alpha helix, what are the main characteristics of it? Helical residues, that means whenever a particular amino acid, if it is being folded in a helical pattern, in that case, phi and psi angle value would be negative. And the typical values that normally in a alpha helix is present, that is minus 60 and minus 50. That means if the amino acids are being arranged in such a manner, as you can see here, this is the one amino acid. So every main chain will be having a carbonyl group and an amino group, which will be hydrogen bonded to peptide bonds, four residue away. That means the peptide bond would be formed four residues away. As you can see here, this is the peptide bond. Herein, this is the peptide bond. The dots are shown. And that means the first amino acid will pair with amino acid, which is four base pairs away from it, so as to give stability. So this is a very stable and regular arrangement. And if you talk about that per turn, how many amino acids are present? So there are 3.6 residues per turn, 5.4 angstrom repeat along the helix axis is there, and residue per rice is 1.5 angstrom. This is a most common conformation. It is a tightly coiled polypeptide backbone onto which side chains are extending outwards. It is a spontaneous structure. It is being stabilized by hydrogen bonding between amide hydrogen and carbonyl oxygen of peptide bonds. The side chain groups, that means R groups, they lie on the exterior of the helix. That is why I'm saying the side chains are extending outwards, and they normally are perpendicular to its axis. These are the same values that I have previously discussed. And if you talk about, if you take up an example in that case, keratins, in case of keratin protein, the entire structure is alpha helical. And in case of myoglobin, 80% of the structure is alpha helical. So there are few, helix breakers, for example, glycine, proline, some bulky amino acids or some charged amino acids. If those amino acids happen to be present in the amino acids, in that case, they can disrupt the helix. Next is secondary structure. Next secondary structure is beta strand, beta pleated sheets. You must have heard about it. In this case, the psi angles are positive. They are positive psi angles, normally 130 degrees. And the phi angle value is negative, that is around minus 40. There is no hydrogen bond amongst the backbone. atoms from the same strand. So this is the structure into which you can see there is on one side there are alternating side chains. That means side chains project out in the in an alternating fashion to the opposite direction. So such kind of structure is known as beta sheet. It is composed of two or more different regions of stretches, that is of around 10 to 20 amino acids. The folding and alignment of these stretches of amino acids or polypeptide backbone, they can basically form a structure of beta sheet that is basically stabilized by hydrogen bonding between amide hydrogen and carbonyl oxygen. That means the oxygen of carbonyl group would be the contributing thing so as to establish the hydrogen bond. The peptide backbone of the beta sheet is highly extended because the side chains, they will be pointing outwards, but that too in the alternating fashion. So that is why we sometimes call these beta pleated sheet as parallel beta parallel sheets or anti-parallel sheets. So this is the structure, parallel and anti-parallel. So as you can see here, in R chain is on this side, and in the second case, it is on another side. So that is why we are calling it as alternating fashion. So this is parallel and anti-parallel structures. So this is again the comparison between the two main type of structures, that is alpha helix and beta pleated sheets. This is the alpha helix. These are the peptides bond. That is, first amino acid will be forming a peptide bond with the fourth amino acid. And this is in case of beta pleated sheets, in which all the amino acids will be arranged in such a manner that it will take the form of a sheet. Next is tertiary structure. That means whenever the secondary structures, they are being folded, they basically take a 3D structure. So we can basically detect domain repeats and some motifs. For example, independently folded part of a protein, that is known as domain. The average size of a normal domain that is present in a particular protein, that is around 150 amino acid residue. There are many repeats. That means repeat sequences are there, that is basically comprising of a few secondary structure element that is stabilized by interaction between these repeat sequences, due to which large 3D structures are formed. There are few motifs also, zinc finger motifs also, and those structures are basically stabilized by metal ions, for example, zinc ions. Next is quaternary structure. Quaternary is whenever two or more polypeptide chains, when they are held together or when they combine to form a complex in a very precise ratio with a precise 3D configuration, that is known as a quaternary structure. The known covalent association of a molecule of beta 2 microglobulin with heavy chain class of each class 1 histocompatibility molecule is, it is being shown in this picture. Now, what is the reason for structural similarity? Why we need to go for the structure prediction? Because sometimes what happens, many kind of proteins, they show similar type of structures. So the main reason for that structural similarity is similarity either can be due to divergent evolution, that is homologous, or it can be due to the convergent evolution. That means if a particular protein is belonging to the same protein family or it has been derived from a common ancestor, in that case, the structure would be more or less highly conserved than the sequence. That is why we mostly go for the secondary structure prediction. If a particular structure is, a similarity is because of some convergent evolution, in that case, the similarity may be due to the way the helix structure is being packed. Or if their sequence similarity is not there, but there are some domains or some certain kind of site residues that are showing some similar type of structure, or that are being folded in a particular type of structure. So those are the main reasons. But what is secondary structure prediction actually, and how we can go for it? Whenever you want to go for the secondary structure prediction of any protein sequence, in that case, the first thing that you require is a protein sequence. Suppose you are working on some enzyme or some protein, you have purified that very enzyme or protein, then the first step would be to go for the protein sequencing. Once you have done the protein sequencing, that means the primary structural, that means the main raw information is in your hand. So you would be basically getting this protein sequence in such a fashion. So once you have received this protein sequence, next step is to predict its secondary structure content. This secondary structure content can be predicted in a manner. As you can see, H would be used for alpha helix, B, E would be used for beta strands, and C would be used for coils. Now, depending upon these amino acid residues, such kind of thing would be appearing. C, E, 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 E. That means this first residue, it will form a coil. Then these 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. 5 residue would be folding in a beta strand. Then again, there would be a one coil, this R residue. And then this complete stretch, it will form a alpha helix. So you can basically predict the structure that depending upon the sequence, which of the amino acid will be taking up the helix shape, which of the amino acid would be taking up the beta strand shape, or it will be forming a coil. This is the first step into which you can go for the prediction coil, beta strand, and alpha helix. That means for the protein structure prediction, function prediction, classification, structural change, some interaction studies, hydrophobic, hydrophilic reactions, regions, active site residue prediction, that all thing can be done by this secondary structure prediction. So there are many prediction methods. This is the basic, or you can say foundation. We normally use many kind of tools, but first of all, we need to understand what are the different methods. So statistical methods are there, nearest neighbor method are there, neural network, support vector machine, and HMM. Statistical method, the most commonly used method is Tau-Fassmann method. You can use Gore method also. You can use PhD, SciPred, JPred. We will be using this JPred method because this is the very efficient one. We'll be using this method also. So suppose you have a protein sequence in your hand. So suppose you are working, then what would be the flowchart? How you will be establishing that which step or how you can go for secondary structure prediction? Suppose you have a protein sequence. This is the first step. Then the first step would be to go for database similarity search. That means you have to go for protein blast. This is the second step. Now the question arises whether your sequence, whether it is aligning with the protein whose structure is already reported. So the answer can be either yes or no. If the answer is yes, that if the structure, if the protein onto which you are working, if that is already known or the structure is already predicted, in that case you go for homology modeling and you directly go for the prediction. This is the one way. In case you are working on some unknown protein, that protein information is not present in the database, in that case you go for protein family sequence search. These are specific databases, PFAM database it is. That means what you are doing, because your sequence is not showing any strong sequence similarity with any known protein, then what you do, you will be going for family searching. That means you will be searching that whether your protein sequence is showing any kind of similarity with already reported protein families or not. If once you have gone to this step, this was the third step, this was the fourth step. Once you have done this, again, if there is some relationship, now the question is whether there is some relationship to known structure. If the answer is yes, if some sort of similarity is obtained while going for PFAM searching, again, we shall switch to homology modeling. That is a different path. If there is no similarity with any kind of protein sequence family, then we go for structure prediction, secondary structure prediction, and fold recognition. From there, we get the idea that where is the domain, where is the active site residue, where is the helix, where is the beta strand, what can be the function. And from there, if you have hints or if you have obtained all the information, you can either go for homology modeling. This is the one way that starting from 1.25, this is 6. This is the one way that is a computer-based work. Suppose, because whenever we are doing some sort of experiments, in that case, we do not go for this computerized work. That thing is basically channelized. Afterwards, you can do this thing simultaneously. But the first step is if you have a protein sequence in your hand, and you want to go for the structure prediction, then we go for 3D structural analysis in laboratory. In that case, what we use NMR. We use XRD, that is X-ray crystallography. And we use MS, that is mass spectrometry. XRD, so that the crystals can be formed and you can predict the structure. NMR to detect the groups, carbon, hydrogen, functional groups. And MS is used to predict the molecular mass of that very protein. After having the detailed information of all these three techniques, you are actually able to predict the structure. Even all the information that are present in the databases, or you can say if there is any entry in the PDB databases, in that PDB database, in that case, the structural information that has been mentioned, that is basically structural analysis data that has been performed in the laboratory. In case of known protein, you go for this. So what were the secondary structure prediction when this bioinformatics basically developed? So there are many generations of it. So this is the first generation secondary structure prediction method. The first method is Kao and Fassmann method, Gore method you can use. It was developed in 1974, then followed by 1976 Robson. Then Gore method, that is named after the name of scientist who discovered it in the year 1978. Suppose you want to find particular kind of residues or certain secondary structure elements. In that case, single residue stats were basically used for each of the amino acids, alpha helix, beta strands, or coils. So the databases at that time was of very limited size. So the accuracy of the structure was very less. In that case, the first method was Kao and Fassmann method that was developed in the year of 1978, which was basically based upon assigning a set of prediction value to an amino acid residue in a polypeptide chain. They were using an algorithm so as to assign the value or a prediction value to each amino acid. So that conformational parameter for each amino acid was calculated for all the 20 amino acids, and they were naming it as, again, C for coils, H for alpha helix, E for beta strands. The main rules were starting from the first amino acid, they were using a window of 4 to 6 amino acid. If in the first window, out of the 4 out of the 6 amino acids, they have the probability of greater than 1.03 for forming, in that case, it will form in the alpha helix form. If 3 out of 5 amino acid with the probability, they will fold in the beta form. So the preference parameter for all the 20 amino acids were basically used, and at that time they were keep on scanning the window and they were keep on identifying the region where 4 out of 6 amino acids were having the probability value greater than 1. And you keep on continuing that session. If the segment is greater than 5 amino acid or probability value of alpha helix is greater than beta strand, then the structure would be complete alpha helix. I shall show you one thing over here. Leave this part. So as you can see, if you are using Kao-Fassmann method, in that case, suppose this is the amino acid. This is the first amino acid. This is the 10th, 20th. Okay. This is the prediction you can see. CC stands for coil, HH stands for helix, EE stands for beta strand. And herein, these conformational values are given. 9, 1, 3, 7, 8, 9. So such kind of prediction was basically obtained. This was the output window of Kao-Fassmann method, but currently we don't use this because there are many advanced methods. So how it works actually, in which suppose you have your sequence, you have to assign all of the residue, the appropriate set of parameters. Then you need to identify the region of alpha helix and beta sheet regions. That means you need to extend the regions in both the direction. If the structure overlap, then average value of probability of helix or beta strand were need to be taken out. So this, suppose this is the you can say sequence of amino acid, this one. Then first of all, you need to assign all of the residue the appropriate set of parameters. Suppose this very amino acid, its probability of forming helix is 69, probability of forming beta strand is 147, probability of forming a coil or turn is 114. In a similar fashion, all of the amino acids, they have been given a value. Now, what you have to do? The first step would be to start scanning the region. Now, what you have to do in case of helix? First of all, identify regions where 4 out of 6 amino acids have a probability value of 100 greater than 100. As you can see, this is the first window starting from first amino acid. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. If you see the assigned values, only 2 of the amino acids have value above 100. That means this complete 6 amino acids can't form helix nucleus. So they have shifted the window. Now again, you can see this yellow one in which we are starting with this P. Out of these 6 amino acids, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, you can see these 4 amino acids have value greater than 100. So it is satisfying this very rule. That means identify regions where 4 out of 6 amino acids have a probability of helix formation greater than 100. That means it, this very window can form the alpha helix nucleus. Similarly, once you have established this window, then you need to extend the helix in both the direction until a set of 4 residues which is having an average of P helix less than 100 is obtained. That means you need to repeat the step 1, 2, 3 for entire peptide. But first of all, if this was the window, up to this we have performed, you need to extend on both directions. And you need to see that minimum 4 residues have an average value of P helix less than 100. So you can see on this side, this will be having the probability value less than 100. So similarly, you can do for this thing also. You need to repeat this step. So this was the main algorithm. Similarly, you need to scan this complete peptide for beta sheet regions also. In that case, 4 out of 6 concept was not taken. 3 out of 5 was taken. Into which you can see this P helix is in... I have taken this thing in light gray color, but this is the beta strand and you need to scan the window. 1, 2, and 3. Out of these 5, these 3 amino acids are having value greater than 100. Again, you need to extend until it is having the value less than 100 on both the direction. That means you keep on scanning. So this is a very tedious task. So such kind of, this is a basic table of Kao-Fastman method. Depending upon which we give a, you know, this is a standardized table of Kao-Fastman into which you can go for the prediction values. Next is Gore method, that is named after the name of scientist who discovered it. This Kao-Fastman method was basically based upon the assumption that each amino acid can influence the secondary structure. But the Gore was based upon that the amino acid flanking the central amino acid will influence the secondary structure. So suppose you have a peptide sequence, then the first thing would be to identify the central amino acid. Then second step would be to identify the side amino acid or flanking amino acid. So again, they were using an algorithm, but they were using a sliding window of 17 amino acid. However, in the Kao-Fastman method, we were using 6 amino acids and 5 amino acid window. Again, you can go for, depending upon the side amino acid sequence, you can go for the prediction of your secondary structure sequence. So this very algorithm was found to be very good in case of alpha helix alpha helix structure prediction, but for beta pleated sheet, this was not successful. Such kind of output would be obtained in case of Gore method. As you can see, this is the amino acid sequence, and onto which you can see C C C C. That means coil. Now, this is the complete summary of this result: alpha helix, helix, beta bridge, extended strand, beta turn, band region, random coil. All of these things can be narrated. Next is nearest neighbor method. It is again based upon the short homologous sequence of amino acid. If they have the same type of secondary structure, the basic concept is again it will predict the secondary structure of central homologous segment by neighboring homologous sequences. That means it will make use of some structural database to find them. Secondary structure of the sequence, which may be homologous or may not be homologous to our target sequence. So in this case, the scoring matrices are used. Such kind of matrix are obtained. This is in case of helix. This is in case of sheet. This is in case of loop. And that will depend whether your amino acid is in butyrate form. For example, this is alanine. If it is butyrate, so value would be this. If it is present on the interior side, then the value would be this. If it is exposed to the exterior region, then the value would be this. So this complete table is already defined. Next is neural network method. The prediction is done by utilizing the information of different databases. That means if you have a linear structure, the 3D structure of protein polypeptide can be predicted. As the name suggests, neural network. So there would be a complete, you can say network would be established so as to predict the structure. In that case, different layers would be generated similar to the things that are present in our brain, our neural system. So you can say if this is the input layer, suppose this is the value that you have entered. Depending upon this input layer, they would be generating or they would be making a complete thing that is known as hidden layer. That means the values would be generated. And depending upon these values, the collective action or the collective values of these hidden values, they will be forming an output layer that would be giving us the final prediction. In that case, that means suppose you are entering three kind of sequences, depending upon the different combinations or establishing a network between all of the input sequences, they would be making a hidden layer. After that, depending upon the you can say sequential action of these or sequential result of those hidden layer, you will be having an output. As you can see, if this is the input one, input two, input three. So this is the input layer. This is the hidden layer. Now this hidden layer, as you can see, this very point, this first point, it has been derived from this also, and from this also. That means a hidden layer due to the combination of all kind of input data would be established. This is a simple neural network with hidden layer. So such kind of thing can be obtained. This is the input layer, this is the hidden layer, and this is your output layer. So it will depend whether it would be helix, whether it would be beta strand, or whether it would be loop. So this complete thing, suppose you are working on a protein, that means in that case, you need to select your method wisely once you have done with it. Because if you are working on some genome analysis or some gene expression study, in that case, a bioinformatician is basically should be very well aware of all kind of tools that what kind of tools he or she can use. So I am switching to this main part. Just a moment. Here the network connection is lost. So I have again joined. Just a moment, let me just. Yes, I have joined back. So I am directly switching to your main secondary structure prediction tool. I shall mention the sequence over here. I am putting the link in the chat box. And first of all, we would be doing a, we will be taking up a normal example. Then I'll be providing you two sequences that onto which you people have to work. So I am switching to this site. I hope it is visible. This is JPRED4. It is based upon neural network. It is a protein secondary structure prediction server. So here you can see this is an example sequence that is already present here. You need not to do anything. First of all, suppose you have your protein sequence or primary structure in your hand. You need to enter that primary structure, primary information, primary sequence information here, and you need to click on make prediction. So it will be refreshed and it will be giving you an output in the form of many things. So you can see there are many matches that are found in PDB. The sequence you submitted is similar to those with known structure. So if you remember in the slide, I have mentioned that whenever you have a protein sequence in your hand, in that case, you first of all go for BLAST. If you are not going for BLAST, you are directly going for secondary structure prediction. So this thing is also present. They will give you an output that this structure is already present in the database of PDB. I am opening it in another tab. We will be seeing it later. Then this may provide a more accurate secondary structure than a JPRED prediction. If you still want to carry out a JPRED prediction, click continue. So I'll be clicking continue. So once it would be done, it would be displayed here. So this is the result. Here you can see. This is the sequence that I have entered. This one. See. Now depending upon the sequence that I have entered. This is the JNet prediction. The complete details you can found it in the summary form also. These are the various version onto which the complete detail would be mentioned. Okay. Wait, let me open it in another tabs. So as you can see. So see here you can see BBBBB is written onto some places. Onto some places you can see this is JNet conformational values 885317. So these are different kind of things that have been narrated. Just a moment, other tabs are also opened. Let me show you that. So I have almost opened all the tabs. Just a moment. Now in this case, the few of the things that you are able to observe here are that means JNet Burel. This is basically showing that the prediction of solvent accessibility. that what are the accessibility levels, whether the amino acid it is in burette form, whether it is interior, whether it is present in the interior surface or it is exposed. So depending upon the accessibility, the values are given. Then there is JNET PREG, that is the consensus prediction, in which the helix structure, it is marked as red tubes. As you can see, these red tubes, you can see where I am moving the cursor. So this red tube is basically showing helix. This green tube, these green arrows, these are showing beta strands, beta structures. So you can directly predict that in your sequence, I think you shall switch to this one. So actually, this is completely showing the structure. As you can see, this is the beta strand, this is the helix part. That means these amino acids, the selected one, these one, KK, starting from this K, these are basically folding in the beta strand structure. And these amino acids starting from this V, it is forming helix structure. So similarly, all of these things are marked as per the colors. Herein, the previous slide was, previous page was also showing one term, JNET-CONF. That means confidence estimate for the prediction. That means more the value, more the confidence. That is why the helix regions, where in the confidence values are very high, onto those regions only these red and green arrows are being marked. JNET HMM means HMM profile based prediction. That means hidden Markov model. JNET PSSM means, that means a matrix had been formed. Suppose you do not know all the information, or you do not have any kind of information that what is it all about, JNET CON, JNET SOL, JNET HM, JNET PSSM. In that case, you can go to this. This is JPRED secondary structure prediction. I have opened all these tabs from the result summary page, onto which the complete detail of these, acronyms that has been used, that would be given. As you can see, annotation bars, Lupus 2114, Lupus 28, coil prediction for the sequence, JNET Purell, JNET PRED, JNET CONF. Herein it is also marked. Helices are marked as red tubes. Sheets are shown as dark green. So all of these things is listed here. Then you shall go to this tab. So this is the final one. Because in the previous page we have seen red and green colors were marked for helix and beta strands. So in this case, EE stands for beta strand, HS stands for helix. So depending upon the sequence that we have entered, they have provided us the secondary structure. And suppose if that protein is already known, so I have opened that tab also. This is the PDB ID. Photosynthesis, what is the title, structure, source, resolution, who were the authors. So see, this is the same structure. This is PFAM domain, Rubisco. This is the large one. This is the complete structural information. We can click on it and we can search that which of the part is containing helix structure, or you can say your helix structure or beta strand. So that complete thing would be listed here. I shall show you. See, in this manner. Here in this arrow, it is showing beta strand. As you can see, here it is a helix. It is showing alpha helix. That means this portion is being folded in this way. Okay? This is the complete structure of it. So these are the protein chains. That means its data is already present. This is the complete detail that could be entered. And this structure prediction is basically based upon the laboratory based analysis. That means XRD, NMR, MS, all have been done. Okay. So you can very easily predict the structure that up to starting from which amino acid the alpha helix would be formed, starting from which amino acid beta strand would be formed. So you need to first of all select, or you need to have a good protein sequence in your hand if you are working on it. Any doubts are there? Okay, so this was all about secondary structure prediction, but I want to cover one important thing more. That is your, suppose you have a, you want to study a particular gene. In that case, you, want to predict its location, or you want to go for gene mapping. In that case, you, the chromosomal location, ascertaining the chromosomal location of a particular gene, it is very important. So for this very work, we can use many tools for it also. I shall be showing you in a moment. First of all, you need to open the NCBI site. 1 minute.